Hey, good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to go ahead and get us started. If you take a moment to wrap up your conversations, settle into your seats. I'm Jonathan Simon. I'm the faculty director of the Center for the Study of Law and Society and a professor here at Jurisprudence and Social Policy in the Law School. Very delighted to see so many people turn out, and I'm not at all surprised. We're here to celebrate, discuss, and all things engage with our own graduate, Keramet Reiter. We are celebrating her fantastic new book, 23-7, Pelican Bay Prison and the Rise of Long-Term Solitary Confinement. As I think you can see from the scale of people in this small room and from the level of enthusiasm, this is a book who cannot have emerged at a more timely moment to discuss one of the darkest parts of America's carceral enterprise over the last four decades. This book is just out from Yale, and it's a special point of pride. I think this may be the first dissertation I've been on that has now emerged as a thing in the world beyond the pages of the University of Michigan indexing system. And it's a great honor, along with Frank, to have been on Keramet's dissertation committee. So we've got a wonderful panel I'm going to introduce you to in a moment, and they're all going to speak from up here so we can record them for posterity. I want to begin by thanking our co-sponsoring institutions in addition to the Center for the Study of Law and Society. We've got two other Berkeley centers, the Center for Research on Social Change and the Human Rights Center. They kind of come, all three of these obviously come together very fortuitously around the theme of extreme punishment and solitary confinement. Although the speakers that I'm going to introduce genuinely meet the much overused phrase, need no introduction, I will no doubt nonetheless introduce them. And after I do so, I'm going to yield the floor to Keramet. About halfway through the proceedings, if you want to catch my eye, we'll start creating a queue for what undoubtedly will be a lively discussion following Keramet and our three commentators. So let me just introduce them now so I don't have to interrupt the flow once we begin. Keramet Reiter is assistant professor of criminology, law and society, as well as an affiliated faculty in the School of Law and in gender and sexuality studies at UC Irvine. As I hinted, she received her PhD in jurisprudence and social policy, as well as her JD here at Berkeley Law. She's also has a master's degree from John Jay College. While at UC Berkeley, Keramet was actually in the first wave of our Bells Fellows here at the center. So it's, again, really lovely to see her out there now generating her own empirical research on law and society. Although she's graduated only 4 years ago, she has kind of published a tsunami of material, including articles in the Law and Society Review, California Law Review, Punishment and Society. And this book is actually her second book. There's the edited volume with Alexa Koenig, Extreme Punishment, Comparative Studies in Detention, Incarceration, and Solitary Confinement. The first of our three commentators is our colleague in the Department of History, Rebecca McLennan. Rebecca is Associate Professor of History at UC Berkeley. She will be known, or should be known to everyone in this room, as the author of sort of the key book on the history of the American prison, at least up through the beginning of World War II, and that is the Crisis of Mass Imprisonment, Protest Politics, and the Making of the American Penal State, 1776-1941. This book won the John Philip Reed Book Award for the best book in English and Anglo-American legal history, the Littleton Griswold Prize in American Law and Society from the American Historical Association, and the Cromwell Book Prize for the first book, the best book in American legal history from the William Nelson Cromwell Foundation. It's a delight to have Rebecca here, and I have myself experienced the depth of her critical commentary, so I'm looking forward to see how Keramet survives. the second of our speakers is Francisco Casique. Francisco received his doctorate in ethnic studies department right here at UC Berkeley in 2013. His very timely dissertation was on the gentrification of the Mission District in San Francisco. Currently, Francisco is a lecturer in ethnic studies here at UC Berkeley. His current project examines the 2011 hunger strike that took place at Pelican Bay and is connected to a larger project that examines the U.S. system of incarceration and the rise of carceral geographies, linking them back to initial European settler techniques of invasion and enslavement. Last but certainly not least, our own Franklin Zimring. Franklin is the William G. Simon Professor of Law at Berkeley Law School. That's the Simon that Simon Hall is named for, by the way, in case you thought it was named for me. Before coming to Berkeley, he was the Llewellyn Professor of Law at the University of Chicago Law Faculty and the Director of the Center for Studies in Criminal Justice there. Frank is the author of just about every book that's ever been published on criminology, on topics ranging from deterrence to the changing legal world of adolescence, capital punishment, the scale of imprisonment, drug control, crime declines. His most recent book was The City That Became Safe, New York's Lessons for Urban Crime and Its Control in 2012. And everyone should be very on the lookout for his newest book, When Police Kill, with Harvard University Press. We'll be doing an event on this in the spring in April 2017. So I'm just delighted to see so many people here. If we can keep the fire marshal out, I'm in favor of getting as many folks in here as possible. You can always dash out this window if things get bad. So without further ado, I'm going to invite Keramet up here, and I'm going to kind of find some place to watch her from. That's just.
Grab a chair.
I think I'd rather get my students in another.
It is such a great honor to be here. I feel like I just came home, and it's so lovely to see so many of you in the room. And this book project was born here, and it would have never happened without a number of people in the room who've been really important to me, as you can kind of guess from the speakers and the people here. So thanks. Because there are such awesome commentators who I haven't heard from about the book yet, and I'm really excited to hear them, I'm going to try to keep this super short, so it's going to be kind of a teaser about some of the arguments in the book, and I hope you'll all read it, maybe. What I wanted to do is just, I suspect a lot of you in the room actually know about the basics of solitary confinement in California, but I wanted to show you a few pictures, talk through some of the background of the institutions and why I got interested in them, and then I'm going to do a kind of whirlwind five things that surprised me in this research that led to some of the key arguments in the book, and then hopefully we can kind of talk about them more and I can answer more questions later. So this is a picture of the cells at Pelican Bay. It's a photograph taken by a journalist and then a diagram done by a former prisoner. I like to show them side by side. One of the things in this book that was really important to me was to draw out the prisoners' voices and their lived experiences. And so I also kind of want you to see their interpretation of this experience of the cell. But, you know, basic background, in California, there were, up until about a year ago, thousands of isolation beds like this. This is at Pelican Bay, which is on California's northernmost border with Oregon, and that institution opened in 1989, and that kind of kicked off this policy of long-term solitary confinement. So prisoners spend 23 or more hours a day in this cell. So that's where the title, 23 hours a day, 7 days a week, come from. The cell is kind of self-contained. It's made of poured concrete, and there is this ledge with a very thin foam mattress over it. This is kind of a picture of a lived-in cell. And there's a toilet sink combination and this kind of concrete block desk, and what you see there is a TV radio combination that's completely transparent so that no one can hide anything in it. Those fluorescent lights remain on 24 hours a day, and there is no natural light in this place. Prisoners look out through a kind of perforated steel door that has a little slot in it, and their only human contact on a given day is usually a tray of food being slid in. Often, that might only happen once a day. They'll get like a bag lunch and then a dinner. So maybe once or twice. When they do leave their cell, it's usually for a couple hours, two or three times a week, to go out into an exercise yard that's about twice the size of this cell. Prisoners have described that yard to me as like being inside the bottom of an emptied out concrete swimming pool. So it is also pretty stark. I'll talk a little more about the hunger strikes, but one of the things prisoners asked for when they went on hunger strike to protest these conditions was a ball and a wool cap to have in that exercise yard. So I think that gives you kind of a sense of the starkness of the conditions here. Prisoners in California were spending not months, but years and decades at a time in these kinds of conditions. No human contact. When I say they get a meal slid in and they go out to that exercise yard, it's because someone presses a button in a central control booth through a computer, opens a door, they're able to go out to that exercise and come back to their cell without any contact. When they do need contact, like if they are required that, you know, constitutionally they have to be allowed to go to the law library, they're in those cages that appear on the cover of the book. Or if they need some kind of medical treatment, they're often placed in those cages. So And if family does come to visit, which this is about an 8-hour drive from here, and most of the prisoners are actually from Los Angeles, not San Francisco, they would visit behind bulletproof glass. So people talk about going years at a time without, you know, seeing another person's face make a natural expression, without shaking anyone's hand. So you try to kind of capture the harshness of these conditions. And then just to give you a sense of how these pods, how the cells fit together, they're kind of tessellated into these pods. Four cells on the bottom, four on the top. So you've got a pod of eight here, and then again, a prisoner's representation of what that looks like. But honestly, it's kind of better than the photograph for giving you a sense. And then the pods are grouped together so that one officer looks out over six different pods at a time. So it's kind of like a classic panopticon where they can look down and see everything at once and actually even see into the cells because of the perforated steel doors. So give you a quick sense of the context and the infrastructure of these places. The other kind of background thing that's really important to know about them is how in the world people end up there. What did they do to get there? And the important piece of this is it's not based on what they did outside of prison. Judges and juries don't assign prisoners into those conditions of confinement. Prison officials do, based on things that happened inside the prison. So in some states, that's because a prisoner broke a prison rule. Maybe they had some contraband, or maybe they got in a fight. And that's true in California, too. You can kind of get in trouble in prison and break rules. And in that case, you'd be sent into this isolation unit for a fixed period of time. Anywhere from a few months to the longest term a prison official could assign there is 5 years if you engage in attempted murder or murder. But the way California had so many people in isolation for so many years was there was another way you could end up there. And that was by being labeled as a gang member and dangerous by virtue of that. And the way you got labeled as a gang member in California was if you had any three pieces of evidence in your disciplinary file that suggested you were a member. And this slide is a picture of the kinds of things that got you labeled a gang member. Tattoos. Admittedly, an unpleasant tattoo, but something the ACLU has fought for the right for people to be able to display of a swastika. Drawings. So this is a drawing of a kind of classic Aztec art, and that would be considered evidence of membership in the Mexican mafia. Or even what you were reading. And the autobiography of Malcolm X and George Jackson's letters are considered evidence of membership in the Black Guerrilla family. So things we think of as classic First Amendment rights for all the lawyers in the room. Your First Amendment rights get checked at the door when you go into prison, and they become a potential reason to put you in isolation. Now, if you get labeled a gang member and sent to isolation in California up until last year, that term was indefinite. So it was for as long as your time in prison. And that's how California ended up with more than 500 people who had been in isolation for more than 10 years. And that number came out in 2011, and it was kind of a shock to people. It really mobilized a lot of reform efforts. So that kind of sets the context. I had studied prisons for years, and I knew about these kinds of conditions of confinement. I had worked for the prison law office. We have some of their lawyers in the room, actually. So I had visited some facilities like this. And I was really fascinated about why in the world anyone ever thought it was a good idea and how they got it approved. And that was what started this research for me, was trying to figure that out. How did this happen, and how are these institutions being used? And in the process of trying to uncover that, I kept finding things that surprised me. And those surprises kind of came together into some of the central arguments in the book. So I will try to very quickly tell you about five of them. The first was that when I asked people in the California prison system why they thought a place like Pelican Bay, a supermax, long-term solitary confinement was a good idea, they said, well, George Jackson. And I said, what do you mean? At the time, I, like many of my students when I teach about this, I didn't really know that much about George Jackson. I sort of knew he was a radical from the 70s. I thought he died in prison. He'd written some best-selling letters. But it turns out that he has this incredibly powerful resonance for prison officials in California because he was seen as this incredibly dangerous revolutionary radical in the prison system. And what happened with George Jackson, he wrote a best-selling book of letters that was published in 1970, and so he was well-known nationally even while he was in prison. He originally went to prison on an indeterminate sentence for a very minor theft, so he was sentenced for a year to life. And while in prison, he got accused of murdering a correctional officer. And while he was awaiting trial for that murder, he was being held kind of preemptively on death row at San Quentin, just across the bay. And what prison officials say is that in August of 1971, his lawyer smuggled a gun inside of a tape recorder on a visit to him. And he took that gun and he tried to escape from the prison. And all we know is that he was shot on the prison yard on August 21st, 1971, and he died. And when the prison officials went back to his cell, they found three dead officers and two dead prisoners. They all died from knife wounds. The gun that Jackson had was never found, and no one really knows exactly what happened. Who was trying to escape? What was actually going on? And that's kind of a core piece of the story, is that people point back to George Jackson as this moment of incredibly scary revolutionary violence in the California prison system, but we don't even know exactly what happened. So it kind of foreshadows the story of the supermax, where we know surprisingly little. 2 weeks after George Jackson died, Attica rioted. And that's another, you know, it's to say that California's story is not unique. There were these moments of violence across the prisons in the United States, and prison officials across the states kind of point to these moments of violence as justification for what happened. So this is just a quick quote from a prison official I interviewed, who I'll talk more about. He's actually was one of the core people who ended up designing Pelican Bay. Just highlighting that he thought there was a civil rights movement outside of prison and something very scary and violent happening inside of prison. And that's kind of the explanation that he gave. So this builds on Heather Ann Thompson, a historian at the University of Michigan, just published a book about the history of Attica, in which she's making a much more in-depth and extended argument like this about the roots of mass incarceration in a much earlier time than we think of. We usually think of it changing with sentencing policies in the 1980s, and this is an argument about really having to go back to a much longer history into the 1970s. To understand what was happening. And just to highlight how interesting it is that prison officials point to this moment, this is a chart showing you that indeed in the 1970s when George Jackson died, there was a spike in violence in the California prisons. There was an increase in the rates of prisoner deaths, officer deaths, and even suicides in the prisons in those years. It has completely fallen off and stabilized by the early 1980s, and Pelican Bay opens in 1989, almost 10 years after we've got almost negligible rates of deadly violence in the prison system. And this is these rates of deadly violence, I should say, are lower than they are in Marin County. So, you know, your chances of actually dying by being murdered in the California prison system are less than they are in even some of the safest counties in the state, just to give you some context. You might die in other ways in the prison system. You see the lawyers in the back who've litigated these issues. But okay, second thing that surprised me is that when I started studying supermaxes, I had understood long-term solitary confinement to be kind of a national trend that started in the federal prison system. So when people talk about supermaxes, the first thing they often think of is Alcatraz, very close to here, Marion in Illinois, or the federal supermax ADX in Florence, Colorado. And so I kind of expected to find a national story. But what I found out in California was that the supermax was an incredibly local innovation. It happened within prison systems, within states. So what California prison officials told me is that they found the first supermax in Arizona. It opened in 1986, and this is an aerial shot of it. And you can see how visually Pelican Bay, an aerial shot of it on the other side, looks very similar. That X is the high-security supermax unit at Pelican Bay, and it's got that exact same, those are those tessellated pods together. And that was the unique innovation of the supermax that the California prison officials were excited to copy. And then, interestingly, this is part of this myth of it being a national thing, this is a picture of the federal supermax in Florence, Colorado, which opened in 1995, 6 years after Pelican Bay. Federal prison architects, I talk about this in the book, talk about how they looked at Pelican Bay. And again, you can see inside, down to the color scheme of this kind of dark red, it looks very similar. So this is again, part of a kind of trend in understanding criminal justice and mass incarceration history better, is to understand that a lot of these things happen at a very local level. So this builds on, Mona Lynch wrote a book about the history of Arizona corrections in which she talked about how many things we think of as national policies developed in Arizona. One of them was this supermax. Okay, third thing that surprised me. As a citizen of California, when I started to try to research supermaxes, I thought that I would find really interesting legislative debates or public debates in the newspapers about what people were thinking about in the 1980s when Pelican Bay was being designed and built. Because as a citizen, I'm familiar with the fact that I have to vote on these things all of the time, and that there are often debates on the op-ed pages about the kinds of criminal justice policies we have in the state. So when I started this research, the first place I went was up to the archives at Sacramento to try to see what was there in the legislative history, whether there was a ballot proposition or some kind of legal discussion of this. And I found almost nothing. This is one of my favorite things from the archives. This is the one thing I did find. It's a little note that was appended to a piece of legislation that was just allocating the land in Del Norte County on the border with Oregon to the state prison system. I know I love people snickering as they read it. And it's just the legislative subcommittee that was approving the allocation of the land, joking about what to call the prison. Casa no pasa, dungeon is dungeon, slammer by the sea. So they had some sense it was going to be a high-security prison, but that was about it. And that was about the sum of the attention the legislature paid to this policy. To the point that when Pelican Bay opened, the judges and the lawyers in this state who had been overseeing prison conditions and overseeing challenges to those conditions in the state found out about it when they started to receive letters from prisoners in Pelican Bay saying, what is happening here and could it possibly be constitutional? So if it wasn't legislators, it turns out that it was prison administrators who designed the supermax. So this is over the course of the 1980s, and I talk about this in maybe more detail than you ever want to know in the book, the legislature delegated all kinds of aspects of prison building to prison administrators in the state of California. So when I asked some of the administrators who'd been involved in the prison building project about what was happening in the 1980s, they basically said, well, you're not going to find anything in the legislative record. We negotiated it off the record. And then Carl Larson, that warden who said he was so afraid of George Jackson, said, I designed Pelican Bay. So someone who had worked as a prison officer and worked his way up through the system to warden and then to overseeing prison building was the one who kind of took credit for it. Not an architect, not a lawmaker, but a guy who'd worked in the prison system. So that's kind of one of the most interesting aspects of the story, I think, is thinking about who's in control in these situations and what that means over time. So I kind of hinted at this before with the question of constitutionality when prisoners first started to write to lawyers and judges about what was happening in these prisons. The kind of instinct, I think, among the prisoners and among the first people who saw Pelican Bay was, this seems kind of unconstitutional for a few reasons. One, in 1890, in kind of an aside, what we call dicta, the Supreme Court had said that solitary confinement wasn't something that people in the U.S. did anymore, that it had kind of been dismissed as barbaric and abandoned, and we don't do that because we know it has horrible consequences for people's mental health and long-term ability to reintegrate. So there's kind of that legal foundation from way back when. And then there were the fact of the stories that were coming out of Pelican Bay at the time. And they were stories of incredibly horrible abuse between prisoners and guards. This is an image from a 60-minute expose of the institution that aired in 1993. And the kind of core story there, I always feel guilty telling the story because it's kind of unimaginably horrible, but it is unfortunately representative of these institutions. There was a prisoner in Pelican Bay who, like many prisoners in these institutions, was mentally ill before he was sent to isolation. He got much worse in isolation, and he started smearing himself in his own excrement. This is something that happens fairly often in isolation, and people don't really know quite how to make sense of it, whether it's a form of resistance, because it's a way people can control their environment, or whether it's a form of really terrible mental decompensation, or some combination. Nonetheless, this happened, and the prison officials really had no idea what to do with this man, because it's obviously unpleasant for both the prisoners in the seven cells immediately around him and for the staff who were anywhere near this unit to interact with this in any way. The man was named Von Dorch. They dragged him out of the cell, and they placed him in scalding water until more than half of his skin peeled off. And worse, in the 60 Minutes expose they uncovered, he was African-American, and the officers allegedly said, we're going to have a white boy when this is through. So the layers of racism and mistreatment were pretty terrible in this case. And this was aired by 60 Minutes in 1993. Just to say, nothing about it is unusual. This happened to a prisoner in a Florida isolation unit 2 years ago again. Exact same story, except the prisoner died. So this is this thing that kind of happens in isolation units in prisons in the U.S. that I think it's quite representative of the pathology that the units create. So there's this sense that maybe this place is unconstitutional. But there's some challenges to actually finding that it's unconstitutional, in part that it actually looks pretty clean when you think about it. So what came before, and those isolation units that were kind of abandoned, were these dark, dirty cells that were sometimes even overcrowded. And in fact, there had been litigation in California about the kinds of isolation being used in the 70s, the kind of places people like George Jackson were in, where there wasn't adequate running water, sometimes there was no hot water, sometimes prisoners were crowded in, there wasn't adequate lighting, the cells were really dirty. And in a lot of ways, Pelican Bay looks like a response to that. These poured concrete cells are incredibly easy to hose down and clean up. The lights are always on. In general, there's not that much overcrowding, although there is some about overcrowding in these units in the book also, which is a whole other story. So it turns out that all of those engagements between prisoners and officers that were so brutal were clearly unconstitutional. But this long-term solitary confinement itself, given the history, was very hard to declare unconstitutional. And so in the end, Judge Henderson, who's the namesake of the Henderson Center on the Berkeley campus, who's an incredible advocate for civil rights in the United States, has heard an array of cases on everything from animal rights to welfare policy to prisoners' rights, ended up holding that Pelican Bay, as a long-term solitary confinement place for people who were not seriously mentally ill, was basically constitutional. So it's another kind of fascinating aspect of this story is making sense of that. And it's a kind of story of legal endogeneity, who the expert on that is in the room, but where there's a set of legal rules that are made and kind of internalized by the system, but then become a minimum bar for in this case, a maximum bar for the most possible rights that would be given to the prisoners. And then the courts defer to those standards that the institution has kind of internalized. Okay, promise we're on the last surprise. I'm almost doing it. So I told you a lot about the history, but some of the book is also about how these institutions have operated over time. And this is a slide showing you, this is based on data I requested from the Department of Corrections when I was taking a class with Jonathan Simon when I was in law school. I think it was in my second or third year of graduate school. And I said, I'm just a lowly graduate student. Can you give me some basic details about who's in the California prison system in these isolation units? And after a couple months, the state came back to me with this data file. And one of the things in the data file was a list of the number of people being paroled directly from solitary confinement onto the streets in California. And it turned out it was hundreds of people a year. So this is a slide just showing you from 1997 to 2007, where at least 600, if not close to 1,200 people a year coming out of the state's long-term isolation units. The time I got this data, it was like 2008, 2009, no one knew that this was happening. There have now been some kind of horror stories about what happens when people are released directly from a cell like this with basically almost no sensory inputs onto the streets of San Francisco or Los Angeles. And it is a very hard transition. Some of the stories in the book are how people survive that and what that's actually like. Lest I have thoroughly depressed you, I will leave on a happy note about how much things are changing, even since I finished the proofs on this book. So the book took a little longer to write than I had hoped, in part because things kept changing after I finished graduate school. And one of the things that changed was thousands of prisoners across the state of California went on some concerted hunger strikes in order to protest these conditions of confinement and isolation. And they were able to achieve incredible reforms. As of last week, of those 500 prisoners who had been in isolation for more than 10 years in California, only 5 are left at Pelican Bay. And Pelican Bay, which has 1,056 isolation beds, I just checked today, the population is about 400 right now. So we've got an emptying isolation unit in the state, and no one knows what will happen to it. So there are some interesting questions on that front, too. But.
I'm Rebecca McLennan. I'm first and foremost, huge congratulations, Keramet. Publishing any book is a real achievement, but publishing one as deeply researched, cogently argued, and as morally urgent as 23/7 is both a rare and truly monumental feat. And thank you as well. Not only congratulations, but thank you for this gift of a book that I am certain is going to change and contribute to the conversation and to change, to real change. I followed and admired Keramet's work for many years now. I first met Keramet when she was a college student, a continent and a world away from Pelican Bay, when she was just beginning to immerse herself in the study of our troubled and troubling penal system. When reviewers refer to your book, Keramet, as I wager they will, as long anticipated, you can include me at the top of that list. Literally, I've been reading multiple papers of yours for many years now, and I'm so excited that the book is finally here. From your opening dedication, which those of you who haven't looked at the book yet, the opening dedication is, quote, to anyone who has lived or worked inside an American prison, to her closing lines about hoping one day to be able to invite Johnny, a SHU, a lifetime prisoner she's worked with, to someday guest lecture in her class, Keramet brings to the chaotic tangle of California's prison politics and the puzzle of how the nightmarish institution of the concrete box supermax came into existence a keen empirical and analytical clarity. She untangles for us the preconditions of Pelican Bay's conception, the identity of its conceivers and their political and practical objectives, the supermax's early development and subsequent maturation, and finally the resistance, protest, and litigation it has undergone in more recent years. She does all this in a very clear, accessible prose style and with considerable empathy, though not necessarily approval, of the various actors, including, as you just saw, the swastika tattoo-bearing suspected white nationalist Todd Ashka and the Attica guards who perished during the state's storming of that prison in 1972 at the hands of the state, mostly, and Carl Larson, the administrator who quietly designed and helped implement the supermax prison, Pelican Bay. You would think that given the monstrosity that is, and especially was, Pelican Bay, that there'd be kind of judgmental anger towards these, towards many of these people, or certainly on the administrative end, and yet there's a kind of there's a way in which you withhold judgment of them, judge the system and the structure, and you're able to get at exactly what they were thinking and why they did what they did as a result of that. So it's a very, very impressive feat. There are many wonderful insights in the book, and I haven't time to highlight all of them. We'd be here for far too long. But first, I really like the deep historicist argument, surprise, surprise, that Keramet brings to the analysis, by which I mean she grounds the advent of the supermax in both socio-historical time, but also socio-historical place. The story starts long ago than most of us might have guessed it would, not in the 1980s or even 1974, with New York's Governor Nelson Rockefeller pushing through mandatory minimum sentencing legislation, but in the prisons of Soledad, Folsom, and San Quentin in the 1960s and the early 1970s. Within the racially discriminatory criminal justice system of the 1960s, the great progressive reform of indeterminate sentencing, which had been introduced decades earlier, redoubled the unequal and unduly long sentences that African American men in particular, such as George Jackson, were forced to serve. Keramet shows us the radicalizing effect that this unjust system had on young men, convicted of often quite minor crimes. And by which Jackson himself, who was convicted of robbing a gas station of $70 in 1961, I believe, was sentenced for 1 year to life, as Keramet has told us, but in effect ends up spending the rest of his life in prison. She shows us how, as a radical black prison leader by the late 1960s, George Jackson was as large, if not larger, in death than in life before a San Quentin corrections officer shot and killed him on the yard in August 1972. In death, Jackson became a multivalent symbol, signifying differently depending on one's position within and relation to the larger structure of the penal system. Jackson was, quote, the most dangerous prisoner, as the title of Chapter 2 puts it, for corrections officers, administrators, and the Guards Union. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Jackson continues to be the inspired and inspiring hero of prison reform in the eyes of many prisoners and their allies, the tragically heroic figure that fought back against an unjust system and died, as tragic heroes do, doing so. Here is a powerful origins myth. In the eyes of many contemporary activists, Keramet shows us, his life, and especially the end of his life, was the birth of the present reform and/or abolitionist movement. But extraordinarily, Jackson is also alive and well in prison officials' collective memory, both in and beyond San Quentin, where he was shot and killed. Indeed, he is the central, apocryphal figure in what we might call the origin myth of modern American correctional culture, the signifier of all the presumed desire of all prisoners to wreak vengeance on the bodies of guards and to threaten officials' control over what they consider their, rather than the state's or the court's or the public's institution of the prison. What Keramet's book makes clear for me, among other things, is that the collective memory of this most dangerous prisoner that is nurtured and reproduced within the culture of correctional officials, and the larger anti-pathetic culture of corrections, not only impelled California towards Pelican Bay, but is alive and well and will continue to make meaningful reform extremely difficult. Tackling the culture of corrections directly seems likely to be a necessary precondition of any meaningful reform, as Keramet, I think, establishes. A second related aspect that I very much appreciate about Keramet's book is that, as a whole, it cautions us as to the dangers of prison reform and of those rare moments, possibly such as the current one, when public opinion seems finally to have turned against prevailing practice, in our case, the mass incarceration experiment of the past 40 years. Keramet shows us how easy it is for well-meaning, progressive, and even radical advocates to grasp what appears to be victory, in this case, the abolition of the racist system of indeterminate sentencing in 1976, which was abolished under California law, only to find that victory captured and retooled and as an even more oppressive tactic of control. Keramet argues that this was more than simply an unintended consequence of reform. Rather, the law and order forces in play when State Bill 42 was drafted played a major role in both determining the content of the legislation, its subsequent interpretation and implementation, and the ways in which prison officials gamed it and evaded it. So, in a sense, these consequences, while unintended by some progressive reformers, were fully intended and/or positively, actively deployed by officials and others. And there is a deep and very difficult lesson, I think, here for those of us who seek systemic as opposed to superficial change. I also think the book has a lot to say about a number of important issues that I can't detail much here. I did promise to confine my comments to 8 minutes. It reminds us, the book reminds us of the political and administrative uses to which fear and trauma can be and were in fact put years before 9/11 and ISIS and the remaking of the security state. The traumatic period of California prisons, 1970 to 1974, as Keramet outlines it, when 71 prisoners and 11 guards were killed, so you know, 82 people within a four-year period. Those traumatic years have never really been confronted for what they were and what they gave birth to. Instead, those years have been instrumentalized most effectively by prison officials to terrible effect. Then there's the question of the ways in which California's version of liberal legislative democracy seems to have, at best, been ineffective against the emergence of this brutal system, and at worst, to have abetted it in the ways that Keramet outlines in her books. Likewise, the courts and litigation, which as Keramet shows us, tried to mandate basic humane conditions, ended up legitimating supermax-style isolation. Third, I'm interested in how you draw our attention to the undemocratic, illegal, not illegal, but certainly illegal, and then later unconstitutional, but illegal process by which, or extra-legal process, by which prison officials effectively pulled off a coup against the courts and the state of California. by essentially, there's a lesson here about how powerful mid-level officials are, mid-level administrators. This was a quiet coup. This was essentially an administrative deployment of power in all the ways that Keramet outlines. And until very recently, and it still remains to be seen, I would suggest, neither the courts nor the legislature have been a match for this mid-level official prison power. All told, Keramet's book makes a great contribution. As someone who teaches the history of American crime and punishment from the Revolution to the present, I'm thankful that I now am finally able to assign a book that so clearly and persuasively explains where the supermax came from. And I will assign it in the hope that my students will not only get an informed view of where the supermax came from, but also how and where it should go. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, this for me was, it was a frightening book to read. Actually, I didn't get the book, I had the proof. And it was the proof that was more frightening to me than the actual book would have been, I think, the physical object. And the reason for that is there's a watermark that runs diagonally behind the words on the page. My brother had been, until relatively recently, incarcerated at Pelican Bay State Prison inside the short corridor in the security housing unit. And whenever I would receive a letter from my brother, stamped in rather bold red lettering was Pelican Bay State Prison Security Housing Unit, Unit D-1. So I was constantly triggered when I was reading the proof about, you know, the interplay between institutions and whether it be the academic institution of Yale University and its university press or the institution of the prison and the carceral regime therein, or of rather. I don't want to go over time, so I'm going to try and keep a lot of my thoughts contained to the 8-minute time limit. And because of that, a lot of what I'm going to say is going to come off as a bit elliptical in some form or another. Attempting to sort out the multiple distorted logics of California's mass incarceration, which Professor Reiter's book contributes greatly to, evokes Humpty Dumpty. When he tells Alice, when I use a word, it means just what I choose it to mean, neither more nor less. The question is, said Alice, whether you can make words mean different things. The question is, replied Humpty Dumpty, which is to be master? That's all. Mastery is, of course, central to the mechanisms of mass incarceration. The isolation of any subsequent allegedly dangerous prisoners in excessively restrictive and fundamentally invisible institutions, Professor Reiter tells us, enables us a special zone of bureaucratic discretion that is not only hard to see, but impossible to regulate. 23/7 is a rich, systematic account of the lightly understood rise of Pelican Bay State Prison, California's first modern super maximum prison, and the use of solitary confinement inside of it. Reiter depicts the fears California prison administrative officials held in the 1960s and in the 1970s as radical liberation movements manifested themselves inside the formal prison walls. Reiter follows this dangerative narrative arc of quote-unquote danger and risk from San Quentin State Prison in the late 1960s and 1970s to and through the construction and the opening of Pelican Bay State Prison in the 1980s. Throughout, Professor Reiter eloquently traces the rise of the so-called security housing unit, the maintenance and the contradictions of Pelican Bay, and then how this is the latest iteration within this long tradition of prison administrators' fears over race, over class, and more specifically, I think, over governance of the prison. As I read Professor Reiter's book, I kept coming back to something that I've been thinking about recently, how the prison and its bureaucracy may also function as an archive. I'm sort of hesitant now that Rebecca's here, the grand historian, to follow through with this, but here I go. I'm going to leap right into it. Archives are, you know, to my mind, far from inert sites of storage and conservation. They are instead sites of contested knowledge, full of fissures and anxieties. The supreme power to conceal, reveal, and interpret what lies within the archive and stolar rights lies with the state. There's a power that the state has in terms of what is and what is not part of the formal archive. Power, Achille Mbembe writes, continuously refers and appeals to exception, emergency, and the fictionalized enemy. It labors to produce the same emergency, exception, and the fictionalized enemy. Indeed, Professor Reiter's work demonstrates how prison officials reiterated messages of exception and emergency in the concern for the quote-unquote safety of the institution, and how they anxiously worked to create new rules to catch up to what was emergent, to what was becoming. To this point, Keramet Reiter writes, and this is a passage from her work, "Every step toward reform just increased prison officials' fears about out-of-control prisons and the loss of management tools on which they relied. Prison officials responded by resisting interventions, grasping for new forms of control, and designing harsher but less visible forms of managing the prisoners they perceived to be the most dangerous to the prison order." 45 years ago, the quote-unquote most dangerous inmate was George Jackson. Today, it is the faceless but still not raceless gang member. Prison officials' drive to identify and stamp out gang activity at Pelican Bay State Prison for the sake of securing the institution has resulted in gang validations for an overwhelming majority of the men currently held inside the security housing unit, the SHU. As Professor Reiter's book points out, every man in the SHU who has been either validated as a prison gang member or a prison gang associate knows the three pulleys that release him from his SHU sentence: parole, snitch, or die. For those with determinate sentences, parole was a known conclusion for their time. For those with indeterminate sentences, only timeless time loomed until their death, or if they chose to debrief. For those who chose to become informants, the institutional gang investigator, the IGI, waited with prescripted text. An informant's positive identification of a given SHU inmate as an active gang member was then ensured that identified man's revalidation for another 6 years in the SHU. I think of Michel Desarteau when he writes, "The law takes hold of bodies in order to make them its text." There is a relationship between secrets, experts, and archiving. Institutions, Mary Douglas reminds us, create shadowed places in which nothing can be seen and no questions asked. So it is with Pelican Bay State Prison and its SHU, both of which linger in shadowy places where the official record is conspicuously quiet. Prison administrators at Pelican Bay State Prison are dependent on the SHU prisoner, not just for the information they give or don't give, but also to legitimate themselves as experts producing necessary knowledge for the quote-unquote safe functioning of the prison. SHU prisoners become the precious collection materials for of which allow the prison administration and its officials to continue to work in obfuscation. I want to close with the following, and it's from Toni Morrison. She writes, "Invisible things are not necessarily not there. Certain absences are so stressed, so ornate, so planned, they call attention to themselves. This is true, I think, here. As Professor Reiter's book points out, Pelican Bay State Prison and its security housing unit
forces us to revisit these silences, these forgettings, and to question again with renewed vigor, I imagine, the question of state power and then also the question of humanity. Thank you.
Whoops. I don't think it's considered good grace if I step on the author.
Perfectly.
Except figuratively. Okay. An aged grump of a graduate school professor would spend 8 minutes trying to sell you a book on methodological grounds. But here goes. Not only does solitary confinement have a long history in prisons, but right now the book biz is just crawling with prison books. So, what's so special about this one? Well, now, imagine for a moment that Keramet was a movie director instead of an author. What I can tell you about the film that would be made of 23/7 is that it would be split screen. There would be two things going on at the same time. There would be the creation of plans and cement and building in governance in California, and there would be the people who had to live in the institution that resulted. There have been some good books about the conditions of living. There have been few effective studies of the planning and creation process. But what makes this book special in its humanity is the split screen. We've had solitary confinement as a process in American prisons for a long time, but we haven't had it as an organizing religion, as an institutional raison d'etat, until we built 1,000 cell, 2,000 person, but wait a minute, 1,000 cell, 2,000 persons? I thought it was solitary confinement. Yeah, but sometimes you gotta save money. Okay. This was a new kind of institution. Now, this history, particularly the history of how it came to be created, and how it came specifically to be designed, is at the point that it was done and now published, very special in one respect. This was a history that was written by, while most of the protagonists, the people who did it, were still alive and talking. And Keramet Reiter is a very good listener. If you need evidence of that, read the book. Okay, so that Keramet's history of creation is itself a special historical moment that could only happen now or pretty close to now. Carl Larson, I think, has died. This is evidence not of something that should surprise us, but of the special moment of being able to reconstruct a contemporaneous or near contemporaneous history with the human beings that made it. Now, Keramet's history of creation differs from the usual story that we tell ourselves about crime and punishment and American exceptionalism in the ways in which governance happens. The usual story that we get is a story of law and order politics, of initiatives and referenda, of legislative structures. But the detailed planning of Pelican Bay, and indeed a great deal of what happened with mass imprisonment in the United States, the essence of its planning and its power and its governance is administrative government. In this sense, imprisonment is not different from lots of everything else in both the national government and provincial governments of the United States and many other developed nations. Administrative governance, low visibility, and a different kind of self-accountability, which is invisible to the other political structures. Okay, what we get in California suddenly is not solitary confinement. That's been around for a long time. But two institutions organized around the principle of it. One an older set of buildings, Corcoran, and one new from the ground up. Why? What is the motive of administrative governance to create this kind of horror? Are these terrible people? Is this just like the Nazis? Well, if it is, maybe we've got to rethink the Nazis a bit. What you find here is a very simple, instrumental need for a governance of mass imprisonment. And here I'm going to tiptoe away from Keramet's pressure and story of the 1970s and dance instead into the 1980s and the creation of a carceral state in California where 173,000 people end up in prison, in lots of prisons all over this state. Okay, you've just been appointed director of corrections. How are you going to run this thing? How do you get people who have been self-selected off the streets of some of these terrible cities in California because they were nasty and didn't obey rules? And how are you going to get them to obey rules? Not at Pelican Bay or Corcoran, but everywhere else in this system. What are you going to govern? Well, what you're going to need are sanctions to threaten and scare and administer the 167,000 other prisoners who you're trying to keep under control. Well, what are you going to scare them with? I think we've seen the slides, folks. What you need is a Siberia. Something worse. But what you have here as a matter of governance is a classic conflict of interest. The duty of the folks who build and run prisons in the United States is to minimize the suffering of inmates. There's a phrase called the least restrictive alternative, which is part of the constitutional religion of penal confinement. So, obviously, it is the responsibility of the people who run prisons not to create gratuitous harms in the imprisonment experience. Except, wait a minute, wasn't I just talking about deterrence and creating a gulag to scare people? What we have here is what is called a conflict of interest. The more terrible the conditions in supermax, the better to serve as a governance deterrence, as a way of keeping the mass imprisonment system running. But if that's a motive, how do you keep the folks who have that as a governance motive from abandoning their responsibilities not to inflict gratuitous pain? Well, the answer is, with that conflict of interest, you can't put the people designing the deterrent in charge of protecting the civil liberties. Only an umpire who isn't trying to corral 150,000 prisoners can make choices of deprivation in the maxi prisons that we create to scare prisoners that are unconstrained by one of the terrible but understandable conflict of interests that exists in a mass incarceration society. So this is an important book. It tells an important story, and it is, it seems to me, also laying a fundamental case for judicial activism in an age of penal restraint.
Can I move our microphone over here to the table if we want to? It's not the wire, it's running over here. And I'm going to suggest that we've got 25 minutes or so. What time is our reception going to begin in the Kadish Library across the way at 1:30 the hour? We've got a great group of people here, and a fabulous meal has been laid for conversation. We don't have a queue, there's too many people. So let me call on some people. I'm going to give you a number. It's not because I don't believe in human dignity. My memory is frail. So I'm going to recognize four or five people, and then we'll take two comments or questions at a time. So you're number one, number two, number three.
How about six numbers for everyone?
All right, so we got two sets of two to begin with. Number one, please.
All right, it doesn't surprise me at all that the invention of supermax comes out of the prison system rather than legislation. What it suggests is that the prison system itself is autonomous and that it operates with a certain level of impunity. There was another system that was operating autonomously with a level of impunity at the same time, and that's the urban police departments. Now, my question here would be, what do you see as the connection? Because you have in the supermax prisons, and indeed in all prisons, the fact that the prison administration itself carries on activities of policing. They're doing it right now in Pelican Bay with the sleep deprivation of those who are still left there, who were instrumental in organizing the hunger strike. The very fact of throwing somebody into solitary is an act of policing inside the prison system. In other words, it turns the prison into not punishment, but the place for punishment, which is itself an ethical atrocity for any kind of sense of justice. Well, you have these two institutions that are acting, you know, like with respect to each other. The police can't be as have the impunity that they do without a prison to throw people in, and you can't have a prison system with impunity that can function without that police department. How do you see that connection?
Very eloquently put. Let's get one more, then we'll
test my memory.
I was going to ask, in terms of validation, I know it's a three-point system, that's what CSR says, in terms of pushing people to shoot. But one of the things that very recently has been proven or shown in terms of the only point that could come from the outside is in terms of your gang database. But I'm not sure in terms of in your book or research, or even Francisco, your brother's incident, or the percentage of people that were recently pushed into the SHU because of the increase of self-crime policy using gang enhancements, gang database, versus before, when 1989, when Pelican Bay was first started. I'm not too sure in terms of how the gang database, you know, was being used at that time, but I just was curious to kind of know some of those details.
Thank you.
So I'll go backwards. great questions. One of my favorite responses on all these questions about isolation is, wouldn't it be nice if we knew that? Which is kind of a theme of the book, of what, you know, what I could find and couldn't find. So I think you make an excellent point that, in addition to the things I said, there were all kinds of ways you could get validated as a gang member, and one of them could be who you were associating with in prison or outside of prison. So if you came in with a gang enhancement or known gang affiliation, that would have been a point that would put you at risk for ending up in isolation. Now, how that changed over time, when I started this research, that was one of the things I really wanted to know. Who was in isolation and how was that changing over time? And that, I mean, it was like pulling teeth to even get demographics, let alone have someone digitize the paper files that the California prison system uses for these kinds of determinations that they have good reason to not want to be accessible in any way, as they learned in the recent litigation when they had to drastically reform this kind of gang validation policy. So that's the kind of archive it would be lovely if existed. I mean, I loved your analogy of the archive and thinking about this place in that way and what does and doesn't exist in it. But I couldn't have said it better. I mean, I think as Professor Zimring was kind of hinting at, I hope that some of the frameworks in this book about, you know, it is a book about solitary confinement, which, you know, one argument you could make is, well, that's a very, very small percentage. Even in California, when there were 4,000 people in solitary confinement, it's a very, very small portion of the 175,000 people that were in prison in the state at its peak, and a very small portion of the millions of people in prison in the U.S., but I think it's relevant because it's a way to highlight all of these issues that you're raising about the intersections between the people, the administrators implementing these policies or designing these policies, and the state and the legislature. And I think you could apply it to the prison system more broadly and also to other aspects of the criminal justice system, like policing or prosecution decisions. So I think nice analogy.
What I want you to talk about is the autonomy and the impunity.
I mean, that's the whole book is about the autonomy and the impunity, and I suspect it exists in other places where there's not adequate oversight of administrators. So, like I said, you highlighted it nicely.
Dr. Platt.
Congratulations on great work, very important work, and congratulations also on having three academics respond to your book so generously and so gracefully. I mean, has this ever happened before?
I'm kind of disappointed. I hear
know.
The controversy sells books.
Okay, well, I want to raise an issue with 143.
Yes.
What the book is very helpful to me is to understand a part of my experience in the 1970s when I was teaching on this campus, but also working as an organizer around prison issues. And from in the 60s and early 70s, I think what made the movement so powerful was this interaction that went on between the prison struggle, the civil rights struggle, black liberation movements, and so on. There was a constant back and forth. I mean, students were going into the prison, there were educational projects, and I think that was part of the danger that that the prison system was responding to, not just the militancy of prisons inside the system, but the interactions. And the civil rights struggle saw people inside as part of the civil rights struggle, as did the Black Liberation Movement. And I think your book helps us to understand how that happened. I mean, from the outside, we knew it was happening, but it was hard to understand how it happened. The other thing is, I think your surprise number three was a surprise to me, the surprise that that this wasn't just debated in the legislature, that there weren't initiatives. I knew there weren't initiatives on the ballot, but I thought that this was a big law and order shift inside the legislature. So I think that was extraordinarily important. And how this all takes place sort of with under the radar of law and actually inside the bureaucracy. I don't think it's an exact parallel to what happened in Nazi Germany, but I do think reading British sociologist Zygmunt Bauman, who was the first to talk about the Nazi regime as a bureaucratic regime and a rational regime, I think there's some parallels there that are really worth looking at and going back to his work. And I'd be interested in your response to Rebecca McClellan's comments that that your book makes us realize the difficulties of reform, the perils of reform, the underside of reform. You ended on an optimistic note, but I'd also like to hear you respond to her concern about that optimism.
And can we get one more gentleman right there, and then we'll be back for another round.
Well, Keramet, you alluded to the mental health issues that might await someone who goes from solitary to the streets of San Francisco. I wonder what we know about what happens to those people, but I also wonder how many people enter solitary confinement with serious mental health and psychotic mental health concerns, issues. Obviously, solitary confinement is no place for anyone, much less someone with a serious mental illness, nor is prison, for that matter, a place for someone with a serious mental illness. What are we doing about what do you know about this? What are the numbers? What can we do regarding mental health in prisons?
So I'll take Tony's question and then yours, Guy. I think I just, in response to my ending on a happy note, I hate to disappoint the audience. And if I don't end on that note, I get these questions about what we can do, and I find them really hard and depressing. So I think Rebecca's response was reflective of how cynical I am about whether the reforms will stick, absent the kinds of investments in oversight and different power dynamics that I think are still possible, right? I mean, the hope to me in the book is that, if we understand better how administrators do this and how little we do, maybe we can think differently about the kinds of oversight mechanisms we put in place. And I think, one of the most positive aspects of the reform is that's currently going on is that the lawyers are getting population reports that look at exactly those things you asked me about why people are in isolation and how long they're being put there for the first time. So there's an archive that's being created now. Those documents are only visible to the lawyers, and there's a fixed time on it until they empty out Pelican Bay, which they're now, as we can see, incredibly motivated to do because they're under such strict oversight right now. So I think there's all these tensions in the process that, there's some hope, but I think, what are we going to do with a 1,000-bed empty isolation unit? There's not much else you can do with that place. There's no place for people to congregate together. So I think there are all these tough questions left in the reform. And thanks for calling me out on the positive note I ended the talk on. But yeah, these are. And then to Guy's question on mental health. This is in the states that have looked at the constitutionality of solitary confinement, the thing that there is a lot of consensus on is that seriously mentally ill people should not be put in these institutions. And I think in states like California that have decent oversight around these kinds of rights, there really are not that many seriously mentally ill people being put in these institutions. In other states where it hasn't been litigated, I think there are. And one of the other backstories here is that supermaxes are also related to deinstitutionalization, and that as you see secure mental health facilities closing, you see prisons getting a lot of mentally ill prisoners. And those prisoners, as the story of Von Dortch, the guy who was scalded, suggests, are incredibly tough to deal with in the prison, and the prison staff don't have any of the resources they need to deal with them. And so isolation makes a lot of sense in that context also. And so, you know, no matter what the litigation is, it seems like people who have trouble following rules for whatever reason might well end up in isolation. And then when they're there, they tend to do really badly. I mean, this is one thing we know about isolation. All the studies of sensory deprivation and what happens to people when they don't have human contact suggest pretty robustly that the mental health consequences are fairly dangerous. There are not any systematic studies of what happens to people when they get out. By definition, the people I was able to find and talk to are the survivors. They're the ones who were connected to community organizations, who were able to follow up on my emails and requests and sit down and meet with me and talk about their experiences, which in and of itself is a pretty traumatic thing to ask someone to do. So, you know, in the book you see their stories and they are struggling but surviving, and imagine what it's like for the people who haven't been that resilient for whatever reason. And the thing that has brought more attention to this recently is a few high profile cases of people getting out who were less resilient directly from isolation. So the head of the California prison system, the head of the Colorado prison system, who was trying to reform solitary confinement there a few years ago, was murdered by someone released directly from isolation. So, you know, there have been a few cases of people getting out directly, and it's clear that they have been pretty severely damaged by the experience, and that that's not not making our communities any safer.
Cal and Deborah Lustig, and then come on, get you next, Harry.
Thank you.
Great to hear this. I've been a fan of this for a long time, and it's so great to see it come to fruition. So I wanted to get your response to what I've heard is sort of three different strands of explanation, one of them yours, but the first is one that I think Frank and then Tony picks up on, the sort of banality of evil explanation. This is, and that's sort of, Tony mentioned Bauman, you could certainly, Arendt is, you know, comes to mind, of course, a sort of administration run amok, organizational path dependency, and you know, all of that. And then Frank joins that with the idea that supermax is a solution to the problem of governance, and that it becomes a deterrent. And then I take your explanation to be more about the moral panic surrounding sort of objects of framing like George Jackson, and I mean object in the sense that he was used, or Attica even more collectively and horribly. And so that suggests a more, a response to kind of a sort of a cultural dynamic of Jackson and the fear of revolt and the moral panic surrounding that. So I don't know that these are all incompatible, but where do you come down and where does the evidence that you collected point in those three different strands?
Can we get Deborah's?
I think one of the strengths of the book is the interviews, and I'm just curious to hear, you know, have you been able to share the book with any of your interviewees, and what have their responses been, and what's it been like?
So I love your question, Cal. As always, you summarize all the arguments beautifully and perfectly. I mean, I make all of those arguments in the book. The banality of evil, the fact that this is a solution to a governance problem, and the moral panic argument. And I kind of peeled them back like layers of an onion, I think, as I did this research. The moral panic was actually the one I came to last. I often said, but you know, and I think, I guess the governance problem thing sort of makes sense when you know mass incarceration. That was the place I started. And then as I started to talk to prison officials, I realized that these guys were not evil. I couldn't, the same way I couldn't hate Todd Ashker, who's accused of being a neo-Nazi in the isolation unit, I wasn't capable of hating Carl Larson. And that was a really interesting psychological experience for me, and I think that kind of comes out in the book, that some of this is a story about the banality of evil and how you think about separating people from their actions and the institutions they've built. And then as I talked to them more and more, I came to understand this kind of moral panic story. So, and I think it's all there, and it's part of what's been wrong to me with a lot of what's been written about mass incarceration is this desire to simplify it down to one argument. Like, if we could fix racism, this would be better. If we could, and I sort of do this sometimes too, if we just had oversight, this would be better. If we just train people better. And I find those arguments, you know, I don't want to say there's no way to reform, but I find those arguments frustrating because then we get, you know, we get a fix like changing sentencing from indeterminate to determinate, and it's not enough to fix a system that's pathologically ill. And I think these, you know, these, all of these pieces come together in isolation, and it can be hard. Again, it's why I think solitary confinement is so important, because it allows you to magnify the complexity of the system and how all of these explanations are interacting in this tiny little place. Interviews. So some of the people who were kind of the most of an anchor in this story are still incarcerated. And so there was no good way to, you know, we've talked about the book and the arguments and the stories, but there was no good way to get it to them. The press has agreed to run a paperback special edition of the book so that prisoners can have it right away, because ordinarily they have to wait for a paperback version. They're only, and they made the first 200 copies free. So I asked them, the first one I asked them to send to Johnny, who's profiled throughout and ends the book. And I haven't, I doubt he has it yet, but I'm very curious to know what he thinks. Carl Larson, who's the administrator in this, had read parts of it before he died, and we had arguments about it. But so there's all this complexity with...
Not
as far as I know. but it's one of the things I've been most anxious about, is hoping that I've represented prisoner voices sort of fairly and in a way that they think kind of captures their experiences. But I haven't, you know, my feedback on that has been kind of limited to smaller parts, in part by nature of the kinds of circumstances they're in.
Our two final ones, so one and two right there. Aaron, yes, you're number one.
Congratulations. I would love to hear a little bit more about the staff. So less about the Carl Larsons and more about rank and file officers and deputies who are also in these spaces, particularly with respect to who gets assigned there. If this is a deterrent space for everyone, it sounds like a really bad gig for personnel as well. So I'd like to know sort of a bit about who they are working in these spaces. And also what... if the conversation that you raised with respect to reform and all the moving parts with stakeholders also involves the union and the tremendous influence that they have.
And let's get one more, and then that'll be our final.
I really enjoyed reading your book. I'm a psychiatrist that worked at Pelican Bay and I'd be really interested in just hearing about the conflict as the treating providers for a lot of these guys and the screening that we do to prevent guys from being placed in the chute, and how the mental health profession has remained silent in the face of this inhumane treatment of people, and also really it does contribute to mental illness. We know that it worsens mental health, and what role we play in maintaining this system that is, you know, its own, they have their own set of rules. This oversight is a joke, I'm sorry, it is, because, you know, they play their little games, and when they know auditors are coming, people all of a sudden, things move slow in CBCR, but when there's an audit coming,
or they have to share information about why people are isolated. Yes.
You know, to appease the outside, the public, the court. And so, I don't know, it just, I really enjoyed the historical background, because I didn't understand all of this, because I'm doing more clinical work, but it's really... a big challenge, I guess, that you're doing, you know, first do no harm, and yet you witness and you hear all this stuff happening, and you're not supposed to object, or you're not supposed to, it's a cultural, a cultural punitive culture that permeates not only from custody, but mental health administrators, all administrators, even the medical administrators, they will bar you from seeking adequate medical care, they will come up with all sorts of reasons why this person does not do this, 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 or that. And you have to justify everything that you want to do is a fight.
Yeah.
And then if you fight, you get written up.
Mm-hmm. And then I need
to show you, you know, the message has to be sent. Mm-hmm. Control. This is a system of social control. Going back to, you know, I really enjoyed your discussion about the archive and about new minorities and how they, I mean, a huge percentage are minorities in the shoot.
And I think,
they're
they're disproportionately represented.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's a criminalization of identity.
Let's get a response then.
And I think, actually, one of the best pieces that I've seen written on this recently, The New Yorker last spring, in an article by EL Press, covered the story of the prisoner who was scalded and died in Florida in a situation like the one I described. And that piece really captures the struggles mental health providers face in isolation, being caught between what I often call the kind of care security conflict, that they're just by definition trapped within. This is something I'm really interested in, I think is getting growing attention. There was a really interesting article by some doctors at Rikers recently in a public health journal arguing that maybe mental health professionals should just stay out of the isolation process in general, that by validating, by sort of saying prisoners are sane or healthy enough to go into isolation, they're kind of undermining their ability to care. And my response was, well, maybe, except we've got a system that's completely isolated and you're the only check on it, and maybe you should do something even more radical and say, no, no one can go to isolation, right? So, but I think that's not necessarily fair to ask of every doctor, as this New Yorker article sort of captures, you know, the vulnerable positions people can be in, and all, you know, physically feeling unsafe in these institutions if they cross officers. So I think, you know, I think it's a place where there's a need for way more work, and I wish I had met you years ago when I was doing this work. I was able to interview a number of psychologists who worked in Corcoran, the state's kind of second supermax, but the head psychiatrist at Pelican Bay told me he better never hear from me trying to contact any of his staff in the institution ever. So I backed off. But it's, yeah, I mean, which is just to say how hard it is to talk to people around every aspect of the system, which kind of gets back to your question, which is something I've been interested in for a really long time. My work really focused on those, you know, those kind of mid-level people at headquarters who were making all of these bureaucratic decisions. And as I was doing that work, I got really interested in this question of who's working in these units. And my kind of anecdotal sense is some people love it and some people hate it. And in the more progressive systems, there are rules about how long you can spend in these units without having to cycle out.
Okay.
So a year or two. Yes. Yeah. And I actually have started a new research project in Washington State. And I said, I'm only doing this if I can interview both staff and prisoners, because I think there is just no research on the impact of this on staff. And the thing that I have seen in California that's maybe the scariest part of the reforms to me is that the staff don't buy in. And what my book shows is that if the staff don't buy in, you've lost already. Mm-hmm. And it's one thing to say we think these union officials are being terrible and evil, and it's another thing to try to impose reforms on them without getting them to the table to talk about what they're afraid of. And again, we may or may not agree with what they're afraid of, but they are afraid of George Jackson, right? I believe that their fear is real. you know, I don't know if it's valid, but it's there, and part of the story is how do we grapple with this institution.
So, you know, just one moment, I'm going to invite you to thank these wonderful speakers and join us for a reception. But I want to remind you that the struggle around the shoe is not over, and I want to invite one of our colleagues here at Berkeley, who's an Underground Scholar Initiative representative, to just make an announcement about an upcoming event. So, Froggy, you want to?
Well, sorry, everybody. Froggy, I'm formerly incarcerated, and to bring full circle in terms of solitary confinement, two of our founders, Danny Murillo and Steven Sifra, that helped start the Underground Scholars, a space here in UC Berkeley for students that have been directly impacted through mass incarceration. Most of us directly formerly incarcerated, but some of us, like Francisco, have family members inside. Well, two of our founders did time in Pelican Bay SHU. Steven, I believe, did 8 years, and Danny did 6. And they found themselves in UC Berkeley at the Transfer Center, and they started this group. And we recently, thanks to our network and support and the work we've been doing throughout the state and Senator Lonnie Hancock, we recently got $500,000 to expand our work throughout the state to other UCs and to fight for space for formerly incarcerated students, because currently there's no such thing, because we don't even belong in higher education if you ask some of the professors or some of the administrators here. So we want to put it out there that a lot of times, like one of the stories I heard, people from straight from Pelican Bay, San Francisco, kill somebody. A lot of times the mass media is good at putting those images, but we want to challenge those images by highlighting that there are people in UC Berkeley that were in the Pelican Bay, now UC Berkeley alumni. Also, like like Michael here, his first semester here, before he started, he just paroled. He just got paroled, and you know, now here in UC Berkeley. And we got other students that have been touched by incarceration. And so the image shouldn't just be this person. The image should be a person with all kinds of potential and value. And we have an event coming up tomorrow for Prop 57, because you know, next week is elections, and we want to try to educate people. I'm pretty sure people here are well educated on Prop 57. Maybe not, I don't know. But I just want to bring it full circle and say that, you know, our idea is, a lot of times you hear people talk about the school to prison pipeline. So we're trying to shift, create a prison to school pipeline, and use higher education as a key tool to reducing recidivism, and ultimately an alternative to incarceration.
When's the event?
The event's tomorrow. I have flyers. I'll pass them around here at UC Berkeley at the Multicultural Center, and I'll pass around flyers for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Speakers, and I just invite you now to join us for a more informal celebration of Keramet's book.
And books.
And